Want to pretend to care about Michael Bolton for 5 seconds with me? Come on, I promise it'll be fun. I'm like a sketchy guy trying to get you to try drugs. Except the drug here is the opposite of drugs, and you're worried about losing your coolness if you even think about trying it. Ah, but wait, that might be the story of the man himself. You might have more in common with MB than you realize. Ready? Okay, so where does this begin?
I can't even talk right now. I'm just locked in the studio. I'll be working real late. Can I call you tomorrow?
That'd be great. I can't wait to see you.
Just wanted to tell you, I miss you.
I miss you too. Go to work. Bye.
Bye for now.
For me, it begins when Michael Bolton was lame and on fire in the 90s. Time, Love, and Tenderness was decimating the soft rock charts and adult contemporary radio. Quite simply, my mom had the CD. But you know how it went when moms had a CD. They didn't even ever play it. Why did they even buy it in the first place? They also didn't even have to play it, because his jams came on every 5 seconds on the soft rock radio that moms always had cranking in the minivan. This was standard issue soccer mom minivan rock of the early 90s. Milquetoast AF. Look, no joke, Kenny G even shows up in this video too. I probably thought, God, this sucks. Though, like most things your parents do or are into, I barely even gave it that much more of a thought at all. That's where MB begins for me. But see, where it begins for me is actually the end of an arc for MB.
Michael, are you crazy? I can't believe what you're wearing, what you look like. In high school, you looked so normal. I thought you were going to be a doctor or a lawyer or something normal like that.
Normal, huh? Normal is something people are until you get to know them. Everybody's crazy.
Moving forward in time to when I was a teenager and could drive myself around, I would hang out in this one little guitar shop run by this guy named Ed. He was a rock and roll veteran, still rocking the long hair, with many a tale to tell and lots of time to tell it. Like, I wouldn't go in unless I had time for the stories. The place was kind of cluttered and eccentric, but sweet old Gibsons and classic Fenders adorned the walls, along with pictures of 70s rock icons, and Ed would tell you all sorts of stories about how he sold Paul Stanley a guitar in 83 and then let him sleep on his couch or whatever. You know, those kind of old rocker guy stories. Anyway, one that Ed loved to drop on you was, did you know Michael Bolton used to sing heavy metal and wear leather jackets and go by Michael Bolton? Yeah, man, he opened for Ozzy, and he even auditioned for Black Sabbath. Now, this was all pre-YouTube, so I couldn't just go look this stuff up then, but we can now. In truth, MB was mostly pursuing hard rock in the mid-70s and early 80s. It got about as metal as it gets in 85 with this single, Everybody's Crazy. And this is hair metal pop at best. It's big, it's glitzy and glammy, the hair is voluminous, the backing vocals are big and layered. Still, I'll give it to Ed. This resides in the metal arena. Michael Bolton gets a metal credit. But what I want to talk about is how in 85, Michael Bolton was 10 years into his career, and he still wasn't finding success with this. This is his fourth solo album. Plus, he'd done two albums with his band Blackjack in 79 and 80, so his sixth album in total. He had been trying, and trying, and trying. Now, we could talk about why this wasn't working, but I mean, come on, look at this. Do we really need to? It'll actually be easier to make points about why this wasn't working if we move forward just a little bit more, to 1989, when it all started working. But not before a quick pit stop back in 1982, when he wrote a song with Doug James called How Am I Supposed to Live Without You? A hit he did not record himself at the time, but became a hit for a singer named Laura Branigan on the Adult Contemporary chart, going to number one in 1983. So, when MB was still trying to crack it as a solo artist in 85, telling us how crazy everyone is, he already had a number one under his belt as a songwriter. Now, this is just speculation, but I'd wager he didn't record this song himself at the time because, well, it's an adult contemporary jam, clearly, and he saw himself as a rock and roll singer. In 87, though, he followed up Everybody's Crazy with an album called The Hunger that pivoted to more of a pop sound. And in 1989, it all came into focus here with the album Soul Provider, which really leaned into his adult contemporary tendencies and finally featured his own version of How Am I Supposed to Live Without You? A version that would become the definitive and a worldwide sensation. For me, though, the most magical track on Soul Provider is the single How Can We Be Lovers? Check this out. This is an amazing blend of pop metal and the adult contemporary cheese, all amalgamating. And to top it off, it's an MB co-write with Diane Warren, who wrote Cher's If I Could Turn Back Time and Milli Vanilli's Blame It on the Rain, and Desmond Child, who wrote, oh god, like every huge anthem of the era from Living on a Prayer to Dude Looks Like a Lady. The video is perfection. Pink 80s metal guitar, padded suit jackets, the big hair flowing, bright colors, a super hook with layered pop metal backing vocals, and the bass is off the chain. I looked it up and it's Hugh McDonald on bass, who also played bass on Living on a Prayer. And I'm just saying, next time you hear Living on a Prayer, listen to the bass, especially on the chorus. It's incredible. As an aside, Hugh McDonald also wasn't allowed to be in Bon Jovi at the time because he didn't look cool enough. He played bass on the track as a hotshot session ringer. They finally let him join a decade later in the mid-90s when everyone was dorkier looking. Anyway, this song here is like a pop song written by an AI before the idea of an AI was more than something in a sci-fi novel. But I digress, because what I really love about this is in his own crazy way, and remember, everybody's crazy. This is when Michael Bolton really gives in to himself, his real self. And when he does, the world opens up. Sure, maybe it's partly due to him getting a little older and being a little more willing to embrace, well, not the cheese, because he was embracing that all along, but the softness. You know, that hard edge, sure, sometimes you need it. But for MB, the soft side fit like a glove. And looking at him trying to be harder in hindsight is like looking at someone trying to pull off an outfit that just doesn't quite fit. I mean, he could do it. He's super talented, attractive. He's got great pipes, but it didn't look comfortable. It wasn't his strike zone. When he found his strike zone, he was unstoppable. He let go a little, and in letting go, it all finally came to him. And I can't help but think there's a lesson here for all of us, about all of ourselves, in this story from the Soul Provider himself. So, hey, thanks, Michael. Everybody's crazy anyway. Let your geek flag fly.